Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Our meeting will now come to order, and I'm going to ask Mr. Sutton if he'll give the invitation, please.
Thank you. If we could have a moment, please. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for another beautiful day. Thank you for allowing us to be able to come together in a free society and discuss the county's business, the business at hand, and also hear of any other concerns that citizens have. Be with us this summer as we approach a hot summer with people having hardships financially to pay their bills. Please be with our military worldwide as they try to keep us free and keep us from being harmed by those who wish to harm us. And help us remember that in the Bible that it does state that if we will ask for forgiveness, that our nation will be healed. Help us to try to implement that promise. Amen.
Amen. Okay, next we'll have the public comments, and I'm going to start with Mr. Webster, unless you want to wait till last.
I would like to postpone what I might say.
Okay. So I'm going to go to Christopher Tate. Christopher, are you ready, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
We'll come right on up.
Good evening. My name is Christopher Tate, and I'm from Burlington. On behalf of the Alamance Amateur Radio Club and all of the amateur radio operators of the state of North Carolina, I invite you to come to the Amateur Radio Relay League's annual field day. This year we will have it at the Burlington Police Club beginning this Saturday afternoon at 2 p.m. and this event continues all night until 2 p.m. on Sunday afternoon. Field day is emergency preparedness exercise. Amateur radio operators will work in the next 24 hours to set up a station, a complete station that is, and attempt to contact as many other field day stations as possible under simulated emergency conditions. Amateur radio operators do provide emergency communications in events such as the recent tornadoes. We also provide non-emergency communications for events such as charity walks and parades. For many people, amateur radio is an enjoyable hobby, whether it's enjoying talking to people or getting to do community service. Many people that choose to receive their license have a lot of fun with amateur radio. I know I have had a lot of fun. If you attend field day, you can see and experience what it is like to talk to people across the state and the nation at a station that is just for the public. And above all, I hope that you can attend. Thank you for your time.
What time is it, Chris?
The time, that will be Saturday afternoon, June 25th at 2 p.m. And this event continues literally all night long until 2 p.m. Sunday afternoon, the 26th.
Thank you. Oh, and I do want to remind you that you only have 3 minutes, which you made yours good, Chris, for your presentation.
Good job.
And at the end of the 3 minutes, the buzzer will go off, and I expect you to stop at that time. So next on our list is John Peterson.
Christopher. I got your campaign slogan ready. CQ, Christopher County Commissioner.
Good evening. My name is John Peterson, and I'm here with a group of Alamance County citizens to express our concerns about the derogatory and divisive public statements made by one of our county commissioners on a local radio program recently. Time does not allow, nor do we feel it is beneficial to debate the veracity of each statement made by the commissioner. However, we strongly believe that these type of reckless and inciting statements from our elected leader have no constructive value and only serve to damage our community in a litany of ways. For example, many of us who engage in county businesses realize that these type of racially charged statements are allowed, if they are allowed to be perceived as the prevailing attitude of our citizenry, that it will impact our economic development efforts, which in turn hurts our employment and tax base, which in turn hurts our educational system, which in turn provides opportunity for increased crime and decreased public health. So we are all adversely impacted when our leaderships do not lead with integrity and compassion, but rather intimidate through harsh words and actions. Will everyone who agrees with me now please stand? We're here to specifically address four issues as it relates to the commissioner's damaging remarks. One, while our commissioner feels that blacks turn their back on crime and their community, people like Mr. Tavares Van Hook, Reverend Larry Covington, and Mr. Lamont Hatfield, all through their efforts to improve our community, prove that this is incorrect. Two, we feel that an elected official is representing our county at all times, regardless if they're in a meeting or not, and that these type of inflammatory comments and prejudiced views are in conflict with the commissioner's own code of ethics, as we reviewed here with a couple of attorneys. Three, as previously implied, our efforts here tonight are not about black versus white, but rather about right versus wrong. And we're here to highlight the fact that our leadership should enhance and build our county, not divide it and tear it down. And last, Dr. Martin Luther King once wrote, "In this generation, we will not merely repent for the hateful words and actions of a few bad people, but we will also repent for the appalling silence of many good people." So we're asking you and other community leaders now not to remain silent on this issue. As often, our silence is interpreted as a tacit agreement and actually strengthens the negative impact that these types of statements have on our community. We trust that you will understand and take our concerns in the constructive manner that they were given. We look forward to your reply in whatever method you feel comfortable, and we thank you for this time.
Thank you. Now, if the commissioners would like to comment on that.
Well, I was hoping
Hugh, wait a minute. Hugh, do you want to speak?
Yes, indeed.
Okay, I'm sorry. Thank you. And remember now, you have 3 minutes, Mr. Webster.
I think so, and I will stop when the three-minute buzzer goes off.
Thank you.
I have observed one person in particular, Mr. Graves. Are you here, Mr. Graves? Repeatedly call various people racist and you play the race card. I've had it played on me when I didn't deserve it. I personally am not a friend of Tim Sutton, but I think he's one of the hardest working public servants we have ever had here. I am offended that he is attacked in such a manner for saying what is just the bare truth. The same thing that has been said by numerous black leaders in the United States. We all know it's true. We've heard it said by Bill Cosby and other black leaders. Now, I wish that the black leadership of this state, this county, this country could fall in and do something positive for the health and welfare of the youth that's just getting shot up in drive-by shootings. I'm listening to the words of the blacks and of the whites, of the poor. I am personally offended that this sort of tack is being taken, Commissioner Boswell, and I'm offended that Commissioner Sutton is being attacked in this manner. It is time that the black community, the black leadership in the community, and the white leadership step up and call for positive action rather than just harum scarum race card attacks. Now, I'll be glad to have a conversation with anybody who wants to have one with me.
This will have to be, unless it's the commissioners. Only the audience cannot respond.
I'm offering to meet with anybody, anywhere, anytime, unless it's during my work hours. So if any commission. And
commissioners,
Madam Chair,
yes,
thank you for hearing me out.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
And the rest of you, too, commissioners.
Okay, now I'll have commissioners' comments, please, and there will be no comments from the audience.
Now, I think it's obvious of why we don't want to have public comments back to people who address us at the end of our meeting. They would have had to have waited about an hour. I listened very reverently and mannerly to the comments that were just made. They have a right to come here, obviously, but what is amazing to me is that nobody seemed to have, they haven't gone to the forum where this really took place. They want to call Talk Line and talk about it. I've called that show for over 20-some years. I don't call and tell who I am. I don't call and say I'm a county commissioner. I call that show before I was elected. I call it while I'm elected, and I'll call it after I'm not in office. I called about a sincere feeling that I had about seeing a little girl's coffin being carried down the church steps in Durham, a white coffin of a girl that was needlessly murdered in her neighborhood. I wasn't trying to make political hay out of this, as I think people are trying to make now out of this. I think a lot of this is politics. I'm not going to give a lot of anecdotal comments. I gave Mr. Peterson last week about my life, my lifestyle, how I've raised my family, how I've raised my boys. But I can tell you now that I've seen a lot in my life that I'm not proud of. I've seen a lot improve over the years. We've got a lot more to do. But I can tell you now that it's strange to me when you're going to sit tonight and watch a DVD, words spoken of a community activist in Durham, and you'll hear his words, but in case the volume is low, you'll hear him say, quote, "I don't know why they're criticizing the commissioner. He's just telling the truth. He just happens to be white. He's just telling the truth." And he says, "This is why I do what I do." He's very involved in Durham. He worked for the Durham Police Department. He organized a rally after that girl was murdered. He's worked with the NAACP. He's been highly recognized as somebody who's in the community, knows what's going on, and I was referring to Durham. Yes, I made a broad-based statement. Granted, it might have been I could have put a little more cupcake-ish approach on it, but people who know me know that's not my style. But I don't really duck what I said. I want our world to be better. I want our communities to be better. Not long after that shooting took place in Greensboro, Summit Avenue, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, 24 shots were exchanged. Half of them, well, about 60% going toward the shopping center, 40% coming back out to the road. In the middle of the afternoon, people being shot in Greensboro like crazy. At 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, late in the evening. You know, the court of public opinion doesn't end in this room. It ends outside. This room and in outside inclusively. And it doesn't stop necessarily Alamance County. Granted, I'm an Alamance County Commissioner, but I'm a citizen of this country foremost. It's hard to, you know, I don't make statements trying to figure out who's going to side with me and who's not. Whether it be the majority, minority, numerically wise, whether it's going to be my constituency or not. Tim Sutton says what Tim Sutton thinks. If it bothers people, it's just going to have to bother. I was born here, left here when I was about 5 years old, lived in Alabama, South Carolina, Virginia. I've seen it all. And I think I live my life in a positive manner. Maybe I just don't say the words as sweet as some people want to hear. But it's hard to think that you might have been wrong when you have a co-host of the biggest radio show in Raleigh send you an email that says, "Dear Tim, I just wanted to write and commend you for having the courage to speak the truth." Barry Saunders, front page of the Raleigh News and Observer, second biggest paper in the state, highly regarded black columnist. He said, quote, well, I won't need to read it. He said, I was one angry Negro when I heard what he said. I had only two words for him. No, not those two, he said, but right on. You'll see the comment here of this Durham activist, but let me tell you, at my house, my phone is just full of messages from all over the state where people heard this. I don't hear Dixie playing in the background. I don't hear it. These are good Americans calling me saying, we agree with you. Now, you and I were talking outside, and I said that a man called me, and then I felt like he was a minority, and I think you said, how did you know? And I think I said, maybe again, rough around the edges. He sounded like he might be. Well, I found him, and I called him. And yes, he is a black. He and his wife work in a black, basically a minority. The school system is majority blacks. He is there to help in some special programs. I'm not going to identify him because he's scared he'll lose his job. Not over this. He's just scared he's going to lose it over the budget crisis anyway. His wife's a school teacher. They put me on the speakerphone. They said they heard about this, Channel 14. And they said, we couldn't agree with you more. He said on my recorder, we needed to hear this. We needed to hear it. He said it twice. And when I talked to him, we shared. And he said that he's around black children every day. And his wife was just in total agreement. They said, they were talking about the no snitch policy. Tim Sutton didn't bring it up. He brought it up. Barry Sanders brought it up. A radio host out of Raleigh brought it up. It's ingrained out there in a lot of people's minds. There's a, quote, no snitch policy. I didn't create that. But I just want us to do better. And what is shocking to me is that we didn't take an opportunity here to do something positive, even if it was rough around the edges. We didn't take the opportunity to do something positive. We jumped on a bandwagon of let's get him. Well, in all honesty, you know what it really made me get fired up to say and tell you right now? I was going to basically not run again. I was going to serve out this term, let it be 20 years, and take off. But I ain't going to do it. I'm going to run again. Put somebody up and let's see what happens. I have to go with the majority on how I'm. Let's play this and let's watch it and I'll be through.
Was it racist or was he telling the truth? We're talking about the Alamance County Commissioner who made a controversial comment about crime and drugs. Diane Rodriguez has the story.
Tim Sutton has been an Alamance County Commissioner for nearly 20 years, but most recently, he says he's been shocked by the spate of shootings in neighboring Durham County, including one that killed 13-year-old Shekinah China. On Monday, he called into a local radio station to sound off.
Do you think for a moment, I'm just being honest about it, do you think for a moment whites would let people do that without standing? You're going to face them, you're not going to be able to do it. We're going to either take you or you're going to take them.
I don't know that it has anything to do with the color of one's skin.
I think the black community turns their back on stuff. They're afraid to confront the people that are doing it. Socioeconomic, if you don't have a man in the house, if you have divorce rates or no married rates that are what they are, I guess maybe you don't have anybody to confront the people that are doing it.
Commissioner Sutton says he doesn't want to do an on-camera interview. In fact, he says he's getting inundated with requests and is declining them. But he told me he stands by his comments, which may have been rougher on the edges, but not racist. And a prominent community activist in Durham agrees.
Tim Sutton spoke the truth. He happens to be white, but he's telling the truth.
Sidney Brody grew up in Durham and organized recent vigils after China's death.
No, blacks, well, we don't do enough. We don't. And that's part of my outrage. Accusations of the commissioner's comments being racist is a diversion, and I don't know why I don't know why a black leader would hone in on something like that. We've got young black boys shooting 13-year-old black girls here in our city.
Brody says until people stand against crime, the killings will continue, and Sutton's comments will continue to ring true. Cheyenne Rodriguez, ABC 11 Eyewitness News.
So I'm going to conclude with this. I'm willing to talk to anybody at any time. I'd like to see our community have a positive forum on what we can do to make things better. And it not be an attack session. It not be a cutthroat session. Just talk about it as Americans. Talk about it as North Carolinians. Not black, white. Now, I know what I said. But you got a guy right there that's in the heart of the war. He agrees with me. Now, as I told Mr. Peterson outside, if I'm going to worry about who liked what I said and who didn't, you've got some good comments, but I've got some good support too. So with all that said, God bless all of you, and I'll meet with you at any time. And again, I would like to see us have a forum in this community of what we can do to make things better. But it need not be an attack session on everybody involved, and just but be blunt about it, be open about it, and be honest about it. But I think you saw an honest man there. I think I saw an honest man here. But who am I to believe is more important or more right? This guy right here has been in gospel music, been involved in music in Durham his whole life. He's got credentials coming out of his back pocket of involvement in that community. And Burlington's nothing compared to the zone down there. I'll take his words of support, no offense, over a lot of other critics. Enough said by me. I'm sorry if I offended anybody.
Thank you. Any more comments from commissioners?
But well, I think I do need to make one or two here. They have had forums, Tim. At Ebenezer, they had some about a year ago. Had the sheriff, had the lot of people involved in that. And I think maybe you're right. It's time to do that. It's time to have it again. Mm-hmm. And let's get together, not be divided.
Any more comments?
I don't need to say a thing.
Okay. Well, if not, we will close the public comment session and we'll go to PBH presentation. Ms. Deanna Campbell, who is the Chief Administrative Officer for Piedmont Behavioral Health. Did I say that right, Deanna?
You did. Yes, you did. I have a couple of handouts here. You know what? I just sent it that. Yeah.
Oh, thanks.
There you go. Sorry about that.
And I have a couple left over the end. Dan, I have a couple left over.
Oh. Well, I'm not sure if Craig got one.
Sorry, yeah, I got one. Thank you.
Tori, you got one? Tori needs one there.
Okay, I am Deanna Campbell. I'm the Chief Administrative Officer for PBH, and we are very excited about the fact that Alamance County is going to be joining us in our Medicaid waiver beginning October the 1st. So I just came tonight to do a short presentation and answer any questions that the Commission may have. We are in the process right now of beginning to do community meetings throughout Alamance County to talk to stakeholders and consumers about our program. So I'm just going to talk to you a little bit tonight about, you know, what we've been doing at PBH and what we plan to do in the future. We saw several years ago that state funding was being reduced and that dollars for mental health and substance abuse developmental disability services were not growing. As a matter of fact, they haven't had an increase since the 1990s. And so we at PBH only have about 20% of our budget coming from state funds. About 4% of our budget comes from county funds. We were looking for a way to change how we fund behavioral health services in North Carolina. We began the PBH demonstration project several years ago. We have operated that project for the past 6 years. And what we are doing is a management of all public resources. So we take all of our Medicaid dollars, our state dollars, all our federal funds, and our state institution dollars. We combine all that to manage all the care for consumers in our five-county area. We use managed care tools to achieve those public goals. And just a few of those managed care tools include capitation, which is how we get paid so that we can then turn around and pay providers who provide services to consumers. So we are the payer of claims. We get paid by Medicaid. We turn around and pay providers. We do have rate setting authority, so in some instances, we do adjust our rates that we pay based on local conditions. For example, one of the services that we pay a higher rate than Medicaid does is all of our physician services are paid at almost twice the amount that Medicaid pays. We do have a closed network, which means that we only have a certain number of providers. However, as we're moving into Alamance County, we will be taking all of the providers that are currently in your network serving your consumers. They will be allowed to join the network. We use utilization management that allows us to ensure that consumers receive the most appropriate services and amounts of treatment that they need. We also are able to do care coordination, which is an important activity that really lets us manage the services for folks. Managed care systems coordinates, and what I want you to notice is the first thing on that slide is people, because that's really what PBH is all about. We really want to be able to help as many people as we possibly can and use the resources that we are given in a way that really supports the community as a whole. We also coordinate benefit packages, just like any other insurance company, and we also coordinate outcomes. So we can look at outcomes both individually or in an aggregate situation. So when you look at managed care roles and responsibilities, this is where you begin to see what are the things that are important in a managed care system. You want easy access, you want authorization for services, you want quality services, and you want health and safety assurances. And on the right side of that slide, it does give you a little bit of information about what we are able to do and what consumers are able to do. So you can see on there that a couple of things that are important is if consumers do not agree with the amount of service that they're authorized, they can go to see us and get local reconsideration. They can file formal appeals through the Office of Administrative Hearings. We do have grievance tracking, so we really encourage people to complain and let us know when they're not happy about something. We also do investigations of complaints related to our provider system. So lots of other things on there, but those are just a few. Managed care versus the fee-for-service system. This is some of what we're talking about. There is a difference between a fee-for-service system and what we are going to be doing in Alamance County. Most medical services are under a fee-for-service model. The PBH demonstration functioned as a prepaid health insurance plan. So we are a managed behavioral health organization, and we do this with all of our Medicaid, state, and federal dollars. We pay for defined benefit packages to identified target populations of people through an approved provider network. We provide both basic benefits and enhanced services. That's probably somewhat important to your consumer constituents because they currently are able to access basic and enhanced benefits. Medicaid waivers reflect a private insurance approach to managing public dollars. So this is a little bit of a new idea in North Carolina. We have been operating two waivers under contract with the Division of Medical Assistance. We do receive capitation payments each month for each Medicaid consumer, whether the person receives services or not. We are an at-risk provider of services, which means that we are the ones who are financially responsible for all the consumers from Alamance County. At-risk means that we must provide the medically necessary services to anyone who presents for services. Medicaid recipients are entitled to all medically necessary services. Our basic waiver design, we operate a combination 1915B and 1915C waiver. We authorize and provide all the services. The 1915C waiver is specifically for the developmental disability population and is unique to the PBH catchment area. Our provider network is maintained on an as-needed capacity. And our Medicaid pays the PBH per member per month payment. This is considered payment in full. PBH then turns around and pays the provider network. The biggest change in the system that you'll see, it is a system that is coordinated and managed for optimal outcomes for the people that we serve. Our goal is to control the growth of Medicaid expenditures, not to control costs. And we think that that is very important. As we all know, if the health bill continues to be in existence as it is on the books today, in 2014, we expect to see a 40% growth in the Medicaid population. But there really aren't going to be more Medicaid dollars. So it's very important that we be able to control the growth of the expenditures rather than the costs. Here's just an example of how you bend the cost curve in a managed care model. And so what you'll see is it starts in fiscal year 2002 and runs through, it looks like 2008 is the last time this slide was updated. But what you see here is you see where we began, when we began our waiver, you can see in the purple lines, this is how much PBH was paying out to providers, and the red line was how much other counties across the state were paying for their Medicaid expenditures. So this is just an example of how we've been able to continue to provide services to everyone that needs it without increasing budgets. So what are the advantages? You have system accountability. Managed care operates differently in public systems because we serve people as a whole. You know, this tends to be a more fragile population of folks, so we're even though we use a lot of the same tools as a private managed care company, we do operate very differently from a private managed care company. So some of the things that are really important to us is that we want to make sure that consumers get an assessment that talks about what are their needs, how much service do they need, what's the duration of those services. And so we expect to have an increased accountability, quality, and system stability, and predictable expenditures for you in the future. The financial goals of a managed care system in a public system is not to save money. Again, it is really about making sure that people get the right service in the right amount for the right length of time, and that's really what we focus on. So we do end up with a lower average cost of services, and our purpose is really to manage that cost and control the Medicaid growth rate. Primary purpose of a closed network, This has a lot to do with market share. We want to make sure that we support our providers in being able to stay in business. And so we do have a closed network because we believe the only way for providers to be able to have the market share that they need in order to stay in business is to close our network. Part of the reason that we're going ahead right now and we're taking all of the providers who serve consumers in Alamance County is more about we do not want consumers to have to move to a different provider as we go through this transition. We want the consumer to be able to stay with the provider that they've had for the last several years. They will be given a certain amount of time to come up to our quality standards, and then if they cannot meet those quality standards, then we would move the consumer. But we want to give everyone an opportunity to be able to stay in the network. And this just talks a little bit more about how many providers we have. You all have an additional, this is 232, you all have an additional 53 providers that are coming into the network as you all join us. And these are some of our, just some slides that talk a little bit about some of the things that we're judged on or how we're accountable to the Division of Medical Assistance. So we process about 50,000 claim lines each month. We pay an average of $10 million a month out for our services, and we pay fairly quickly. You can see here at the end that we are somewhere between 8 and 9 days to pay a claim. So that's pretty quick. To manage our financial resources and ensure that the services are consistently provided across the system, we have to be able to manage and monitor real-time data. And one of the things that is important to us about Alamance joining us is that it really does allow us to get some economies of scale so that as we work to, for example, build an IT structure that will support all of this data that we need access to, Alamance coming on with us supports us in being able to get some economies of scale for that. We have to be able to track our funds and services for the individual, for identified groups, and for the population as a whole. Some of what is a little bit different about PBH in terms of how we're going to be operating in Alamance County is that you will continue to have a local office here in Alamance County, and that will be your local community operations center. We will continue to have our back office functions happening at our Kannapolis office, but your local office here will be responsible for working with your network, working with your consumers, and the general public. Again, we're looking at data all the time, so we're always looking for that real-time data. We want to look at how much money we have, how many consumers are enrolled in services, how many authorizations and referrals we have out. We want to look at our network of providers and know exactly what kinds of services they can provide and to which consumers. We also will have the utilization and financial management. This part will also be at our Kannapolis office. And this is where we are going to be working on assigning various services to the continuum of care and through our budget projections be able to make sure that we are not spending more money or authorizing more services than we have money to pay. So that's a lot of what the financial management reports are doing. And this just LME management slide just talks a little bit about all the different particular activities that happen in a managed care system. And again, part of these will be done at our office in Concord, but the majority of them will be done here at your local office. This is about our accountability, just that, you know, we have DMA looking at over 60 identified outcomes that we have to report on every month or every quarter. So there is always a lot of folks who are behind you looking at us to make sure that we are meeting the targets that they've set for us. oversight as a managed care entity. We share with the state responsibility for calculating and reporting on performance indicators. We also have full accreditation with NCQA, which is the accrediting body for managed behavioral health organizations. We have additional oversight in relation to the C waiver subject. And that is simply because it's a little unusual to have a 1915C waiver. It's something unique to North Carolina. Some of the additional information that we track, this tells the board, and this particular slide goes to our board of directors every month, how fast we are resolving grievances. And so if you see there, we our goal is under 30 days, but almost every month for in 2009 and 2010, we were under that goal. We also look at our inpatient bed days, how many bed days we use. This particular slide shows you the total number. Here's our baseline in the light blue. The dark blue is our state hospital utilization, and the purple is our community hospital utilization. We will be working closely with Alamance Regional. We would like to continue to work with them as the LME currently does to buy beds for the local community here in your community so that folks stay close to home. This slide talks a little bit about our treatment authorization requests. This is important because your providers in our network are always concerned with making sure that their authorization requests are approved. And so we look at, you can see this is 2010, 4 months across 2010. So this is the number, total number of authorization requests that we approved. This is the number reviewed within 14 days. So we're at a compliance rate. You can see in the high 90s all the way across there. The average number of days to review a treatment authorization request, not really sure what happened there in that month. It looks like I was going to say we had more authorizations, but we actually had less. So I'm not really sure what happened that month. But what we do know is that we tend to stay somewhere around 5 to 10 days for an authorization request to come in. So then you can look at the total number of requests that were approved and the total number that were denied, and then you get this percentage at the bottom, which gives you the total number of denials. So as you can see, we have a very low denial rate. Quality measures. One of the things that we did back in 2010, we decided that we wanted to look at our provider network and the number of physical restraints that were being used with our consumers. And we wanted to get that number down as much as we could. And so you're just seeing actually the some of the data. Whoops, sorry about that. Some of the data where we were reviewing those comparisons. So, accessibility study. We are in the process right now of completing an accessibility study on Alamance County. That study will tell us exactly where your consumers live, exactly where your providers are, and what services are available in each of those locations. That accessibility study then is the document that we use to help you to decide what other services might you want to add to your benefit package. You do still have some state dollars that will come through your local community office in terms of how we're going to spend them, as well as your county dollars that you commit to the local management entity. And so we'll use that accessibility study to help you to decide what's the best use of your state and local dollars. And that's it for tonight. But I will stop now, so, and just if you all have any questions, I'm not sure, a couple of you may have been at some of our community meetings that we started having last week, but I did want to just come and see if anybody else had questions.
How would the boards be set up between the two?
We actually have not yet completed how we're going to set up the boards. And part of that is that right now we are currently governed by 122C. And 122C right now says that we have to all be one big board, which is really kind of difficult to do when you live, you know, when our locations are not as close. So we are working with some of our legislators to try to address those issues and get that before the General Assembly.
Will you be using the same space that the Mental Health Board has used, or are you going to move elsewhere?
We're not exactly sure right now. We are
in the daughter in the suit.
Oh, okay. All right.
Provider, well, so I had a little inside.
Okay. We did do an RFP for the local community walk-in center, I believe is what you all call it. We call it advanced access. So we did do an RFP and ask the providers to respond to this RFP to take over that walk-in clinic. Now, they will be monitored by us, and we will, you know, still manage your dollars. We want that clinic to stay in the same location because that tends to be, I think, a location where, you know, you've always had some kind of service available there.
Consumers are
right.
Used to using that.
The DSS is there. The health department is there. You know, lots of other things. And so it's an easy place for people to come and get everything they need in a kind of a one-stop shop. So we want that to stay in its current location. We will likely leave the community operations center staff will probably stay there for a while, and then as we kind of see how things go, we may look for a different location for them. But our plan is that the crisis walk-in center will stay where it is.
Very good.
Eddie, just to make you aware, we have had some preliminary conversations. We still want them to stay. We don't think they're going to need as much office space as they currently have, so there may be some jockeying of offices, like the health education building. You know, we may move, you know, the LME into that location and just move some things around. But the offer is has always been to give them as much room as they still need it.
Yeah.
I think, well, we want to make it the best we can for the consumers, too.
Right. Because absolutely.
From the meetings I've gone to in the past, it seemed that was a real concern from the consumers was staying with their provider and not want.
Right.
They do get an emotional attachment to the people
they
work with.
They do. And we also, one of the things that will be really different coming on with PBH is that we will have a care coordination unit that will be a part of your local community operations center. And we really hope that some of those care coordinators who used to work for the LME, that we'll be able to hire some of those folks back so that consumers still feel like, oh, well, you know, I know, you know, Kathy because I've been with Kathy forever. So that's a part of what we want to see happen.
Very good.
Any more questions?
Just a comment, Madam Chair. The local LME folks have been real involved in the discussions. Mr. Franklin's here tonight, who serves as vice chair of the board, and I think you've stayed very close to their negotiations and are satisfied with the progress. So it's I think it's good, as well as the support from Craig and his group.
I did go to the meeting.
Yeah, and like I said, we are just really excited that you all are joining us. And one of the things that Rick Bruton and I were talking about this evening before we came over is that you all will be able to pull your individual data out of, so in other words, we'll report all PBH county data, but if you all want your Alamance and Caswell data pulled out so that you are only looking at, you know, what is happening in your counties, we certainly have the capability to do that for you so that you can kind of see what's happening locally. Okay. And, you know, probably really will try to, you know, send some information back to you, especially this first year until you kind of get used to how we report data and what kinds of things we collect. We'll probably be sending you some regular reports. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Next is our finance Department awarding of insurance bid. Hello.
Hello. It's a pleasure to be here tonight. I don't get the opportunity much to stand before you five, and I don't know that that's a bad thing. As you've seen in your packets, we have presented to you a new insurance carrier for the coming fiscal year for your consideration. This program is a high retention program, very similar to our health insurance program and our workers' comp program, and those have been very successful for us. It's our intention with this program that we will set up a separate line item in the budget to monitor all the expenses that we have with this program. And that way we can determine if we're really doing well or not, and that way we can make a decision at the end of the fiscal year whether to continue on or to revert back to a regular insurance program. In reviewing this program, we spoke with risk manager Darwin Laws at the City of Fayetteville, who's actually using this program right now, and he says that it's the best carrier he's seen in years. He's excited about it, he's saving money, and that's what we're after. The county attorney has also had some dealings with the high retention program before he became the county attorney, when he was in private practice with Cone Mills, and he says that that's the best way to handle your control over claims, is to be more in control of your insurance program. Alan Crouch from Summers Pardue, carrier agent that we're talking about going with, is here tonight. We're here to address any questions you have at this time.
Sounds like you're going in the right direction.
Got a nice savings there.
Yeah, we're excited about that possibility.
Yeah.
So we can, you know, if we can save that kind of money, we can divert the funds to someplace that's more critical need.
General fund.
Very good.
Absolutely.
And you're not really moving from Summers Pardue.
No, we are with Summers Pardue. That's an advantage we feel because it's a local company. We're putting money back into the community.
Any questions?
Need a motion?
I do.
So moved.
Second.
A motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
It's easy now, see?
Thank you.
Next thing is the historic courthouse update. Mr. Burgess.
Madam Chair, members of the board, good evening. I just want to give you a quick update on the status of the repairs to the or renovations to the historic courthouse following the May 19th fire. So I'm going to run through some photos, show you what the fire looked like, kind of tell you what's been done thus far and what's left to be done, and kind of when we hope to get in there. This is the room where that fire actually occurred. This is just looking out of the building. These pictures were taken shortly after the fire occurred. This is the room where the fire took place. This is another view of the room, the ceiling. The fire was pretty much contained, the fire itself, to this one room. There was water damage in this room, a room adjacent to it. This is on the first floor of the building, and there was some water damage, and not much, minimal water damage into the room that's below this room here. So the fire was contained to this room, but we had a lot of smoke damage, and this is on the first floor of the building. The room that the fire occurred in, is actually, when you come in the north entrance, it's the first room on your left, which is proposed to be the security room. You can see the smoke damage up here on the walls, and the whole building just about experienced smoke damage, even the basement. It was surprising, based on the fire being contained to one room, that it did affect so much of the building. These pictures are kind of hard to see, but you can see the smoke line up here where smoke damage is up. This is, again, in the center part of the first floor of the building. Just some more views here. Kind of see the smoke damage up there. You can see smoke damage down on the floor. You can kind of see this area here where it's a darker color. We had smoke, soot was on all of the wood pretty much. You can see it as it gets darker up here along the upper areas. You can see the smoke damage here, up in the ceiling here. That's been damaged up in these areas. All this will need to be repainted. It's kind of hard to see, but you can see. So that's kind of all on there. Again, pretty much what you had in the rest of the building was just smoke damage. Of course, we had the curtains up in the courtroom. Y'all had seen that on your tour. Had the seats that had cloth material on them. They had soot on those pretty much throughout the entire building. Some of the ceiling tiles had to be removed in the building. Carpet had to be removed, some of the floor tile. So anyway, the good thing is the cleaning crew came in that does fire restoration cleaning. They finished up Friday. They've gotten the entire building cleaned. The painting started on Thursday, so that's proceeding along. In the next couple of weeks, they'll be replacing ceiling tiles. They'll be putting sheetrock up in the room that was burned and getting that back. They'll be putting carpet and floor tile in over the next month. Their projected date of completion is September the 1st, so we hope to have everything finished up by then. That could change based on some issues, still with some HVAC issues that we're working through, but we're hoping to be finished on September the 1st. We have a tentative date for a ribbon cutting and tour of the building. That's on Sunday, September the 18th. From 3 to 5, that is very tentative. We should be able to confirm that by August the 1st to make sure that everything's still on schedule. Again, we're looking at ribbon cutting and tour on Sunday, September the 18th from 3 to 5. And I do want to thank the Graham Fire Department, who did a very good job. They were on the scene very quickly, did a very professional job in putting the fire out. I think their professionalism helped to contain the fire and to reduce the amount of damage that we did experience. So I want to thank them publicly for what they did. And also with our fire marshal's office, they were very good to work with in investigating the fire and getting that wrapped up very quickly. So they did a very professional job also. So I want to thank both of those agencies. So anyway, I'll be glad to take any questions that y'all may have.
With any issues with the insurance?
It's working out well so far, so we hadn't had any issues with that. Got some issues they're trying to work through, some warranty issues on the HVAC and stuff like that, but the contractor has been extremely good to work with. They basically started moving shortly after the fire to get everything repaired, and they were kind of going ahead, I think maybe even stepping out a little ahead of the insurance company because they didn't want to slow things down, and they were wanting to make sure we were satisfied and everything that was being done, that it was being done to our satisfaction. So the contractor has been very good to work with, and so they have hadn't had any issues yet with their insurance company. They're still waiting to finalize all of that, but the contractor's been willing to step out on a limb, I think, and go ahead and start making the repairs even before they've gotten final word from the insurance company. So they've been very good on that.
Madam Chair, I don't know if this is the time, but I would like at some point in the near future to bring the subject of a possible move by this board to that courthouse. And tonight, to me, is a good example of why we should at least consider it. We had some folks that wanted to be here that were in the overflow room, and I just think, let me finish, please. I'd like for us to discuss it before the media discusses it. And I think it'd be good if we made it an agenda item and talked about the pros and cons of doing that.
Well, we have talked about it already before you got on here, by the way.
All right, I'd like to talk about
you
it.
You want to talk seriously.
Yeah.
We'll put it on the agenda,
and I have no problem with that. Just let me know when you went on that.
And that way, Tim can get us some numbers, more definite numbers on upfitting that to do that.
Well, and the comment that I'll make is what we, I think all of us received an email about an individual that made the comment that why should he come here with the hopes of getting a seat to only be in the overflow room where he could watch it just like he's watching it on the internet. And I think it would create more citizen participation and involvement if we had it here. But I'll hold that comment till we talk about it.
We'll talk about money too.
Well, in all honesty, if I hadn't stirred up everything, you wouldn't have had to.
I know. Thank you, Tim.
Well, let's go on to the budget amendment.
If I could ask, when would the board like to have that on the agenda? Maybe August, when we get a final, maybe August, the first meeting in August?
That's fine.
Okay. And that way, if we do consider doing that, then we can look. Before you finish.
Okay. We'll have that on discussion for August.
Did they have to replace the ducts, or what are they doing?
Well, most of it's a ductless system, and so the individual units is what the problem is. The ones that were, of course, in the room, the one in the room, totally damaged. The ones that were closer to the fire had more soot damage. As you got into other areas, even some of them that were somewhat remote from the actual fire, there was some soot in some of the components, and so they're trying to figure out whether to clean those, replace those, and so that's something that the manufacturer and the insurance are going to be trying to figure out what they need to do with that.
Cost of warranty, I guess we have to be very concerned
That's
about that.
That's the issue that we're dealing with right now, the manufacturer not wanting to warranty it, but the insurer may warrant it for us, and so we're trying to work through that. The system that's in the courtroom is a duct system, so they were cleaning all of that system out. But that's I think that's the only duct system is the one in the courtroom itself. The rest of it's a ductless system.
Did much on the electrical side?
Just in that room. That was really where my understanding is that's the only place we had any electrical problems, and some data cabling had to be replaced in there also. So we were, and then also the lights, a bunch of the lights had to be replaced in the rooms and in the hallway because they were damaged. But I don't know if there's any electrical wiring damage related to that in those areas.
Very good.
Okay, all right.
Thanks for your update.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, next we have a budget amendment from the Department of Social Services and CECOM. We'll start with Ms. Susan.
Just a couple of cleanup things towards the end of the year. Every year, the state looks at the federal domestic violence funds and looks at the counties that have utilized them, and if there's leftover funds, the counties who utilized them have an option on those. We had utilized our domestic violence funds. We contract through Family Abuse Services and pay shelter costs for TANF eligible families. So we were able to submit for some additional funds, and that's the $69.60 that you see. Crisis and energy funds, there was a reallocation. We hadn't used as much of our funds towards the end of the year, so we reverted $50,000 back to the state that was redistributed to another community. And then we received an additional $3,000 in Share the Warmth. That's the Piedmont Natural Gas program. So that's what these are.
Anybody got any questions for Susan?
No, I make a motion that we approve that one.
Okay, I have a motion on the floor.
Second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Thank you.
And CECOM? Commissioners, how you doing?
Fine. How you doing?
All right. Doing well. I'm here to request a transfer of $5,000 from the 911 fund balance into the central communications budget for the purpose of purchasing uniforms for our department. This is allowable according to the state legislation, House Bill 1691, that you can vote to use 50% of the fund balance towards public safety. And I think at the time this was passed, the fund balance may have been around $260,000 or so. So there's $130,000 in there that you can use as you see fit. And I'm asking for $5,000 of it this evening for uniforms for our employees.
Okay. Any questions?
I make a motion to approve it.
I'll second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks. Okay, next is county manager reports.
Just one thing this evening with respect to OE Enterprises. At our May 2nd meeting, the Board of Commissioners gave staff direction to begin looking at the possibility of transferring ownership to OE Enterprises, the property that's currently in our name, and this would allow them to borrow money for needed repairs on the building. With the board's permission, we would like to recommend setting a public hearing as required under North Carolina General Statute 160A-267 for July 18th to consider transferring ownership to OE. We have been working with OE, and there will be a reverter clause within the agreement, and basically the reverter clause would state the property will revert to Alamance County if OE Enterprises Incorporated cease to own the property as a nonprofit or cease to operate the facility as a community rehabilitation program open to the general public. So working with our attorneys and their attorneys, we feel like we are very well covered in case it ever need to be reverted back to the county.
Do I hear a motion that we set the public hearing for July the 18th, 2018?
Yeah, go ahead. We got you.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. No opposed.
And just a reminder, there is no July 5th meeting, and again, our next meeting is July
8th. Do we need to vote on that at all?
We did at our, a couple last meetings meeting. Ago. Oh, we did under consent.
I did. I can get that. Okay. Next is consent agenda. Is there anything you want to pull off?
I don't have anything.
If not, I'll entertain a motion to accept the consent agenda.
So moved.
Have a motion?
Second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, now we come to commissioner comments. Does anybody have any comments about anything?
Did everybody get, go ahead.
Go ahead.
Did everybody get a copy of this? Is there a file?
No, sir. I can get you one, everyone. That was what was approved Saturday. I talked to Senator Gunn today. That is on the governor's desk for approval.
Okay, so the Senate technically kicked it back to the House.
They agreed with the changes that were made and is on the governor's desk.
So the Senate did agree?
Senate did agree, according to Senator Gunn.
I'd like to see that voting record.
It's behind it.
Well, you got the voting record of the House, but I don't see the voting record of the Senate.
But again, I saw him today at the reception, and he did say that it was good from their end.
Okay, because see, what I heard happen, and I could be wrong, was that it was in the Senate Commerce Committee that it included E-Verify for businesses doing business not necessarily with governments, okay? And that it was taken out, and that it was sent back over to the House, and that the House put it back in or something and voted. Now, I hadn't seen a Senate vote. I'd like to see that. Can we pull that up somehow tomorrow? See if the Senate actually voted, because I don't know the total process here, but I do know what I'm looking at as far as who voted. Every Republican but one, and I've talked to him, thinks that you should verify the status of the legality of people that work in North Carolina for anybody over a certain number of employees. Every Republican but one, every Democrat voted against that. And they wonder why they can't find jobs sometimes. I understand that Engel voted for it, and I praise him for that, if that's true. I believe that is true. It is. But Alice Borson voted against it. And I talked to the representative, McGrady, who voted against e-verifying people. And I thought maybe I was going to find a standalone patriot, because maybe I was thinking he was wanting to e-verify no matter how many employees that you had. Well, no. Where did he say he was from?
Henderson County.
Henderson County, right. And he said he voted against it because he didn't want to e-verify anybody, because he said he didn't think it was that foolproof of a system, whereas our own government says that it is. And he said there was the farmers didn't want to do it, and the packing companies didn't want to do it. And so he opposed it. But I do want to see how the Senate voted on this, because it's my understanding it was stripped in the committee and then sent back to the House, and the House put it back in. That's what I heard. I don't know if that's true or not. Hugh, do you know?
If it was a recorded vote.
How does that work?
If it was a recorded vote, you can see it on the computer.
Okay. Well, if the Senate took something out, can it go back to the House and the House approve it, and then it go to the governor, or has it got to go back to the Senate?
Yeah, they can rewrite it, the Senate.
Yes, but both houses are supposed to approve the exact same thing.
Okay, maybe they did.
Supposed to.
Well, I'd like to find out if there was a recorded vote on what it did go back to the House.
I'm going back to my office when I leave here.
Yeah.
And I got a computer over there that's working.
Okay. All right.
Any more commissioner comments?
I just had a question about our advertising we do in the newspaper. I had a couple people ask me about it, said, you know, they do the Times News online. You guys don't have online presence, I don't think. Is that true?
And we got that in our packet.
No, this is just I'm not going to ask for a vote. I'm just want us to consider that, because, you know, a lot of people read their newspaper online now. And Craig did pull me up some numbers for what we spent in advertising last year. We spent $20,583 with Alamance News, $24,000 with the Times News, and $178 with Mevin. And I just think maybe we ought to look at that. I don't know the rates. Craig was going to check on those.
Right.
And, I just thought maybe that was something we might consider, you know. I don't know how it's decided who advertises where. And
well, I agree with Eddie. I think if we, because I saw the analysis also, and if we're spending 50% more or twice as much that we are legally required to, we probably ought to look at that because it's a lot of dollars. I didn't realize it was so much.
Yeah.
So okay. Maybe we can look at that next time. In August, too?
Or we can do that July.
Let's look at July, yeah.
Sure.
Okay. Yeah, maybe we can save a dollar or two somewhere.
Amen.
Any announcements?
Yeah, you got your picture in the state news. You want to join?
Go to Linda.
The County Lines, which comes out of, I guess, Raleigh, had the article about our chair being awarded the ACC Distinguished Alumni.
That's the only good news I've ever seen come out of.
Well, there you go, well, Bill.
Congratulations again.
Thank you. If there are no more announcements, time we are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.